This kid was a real strong believer in evolution. Right after the Columbine shooting, almost instantaneously, five more students from within the Springfield School District were arrested for threatening to murder students, principals, or teachers. In the adjacent school districts, more students were arrested for violent threats. And in one case, an elementary school boy shot five of his classmates with a BB gun while they were playing out in the yard. Folks, what's going on? What I want to try to do in this seminar is give you a more clear picture of what kids are being taught, why they believe the way they believe, what's in these textbooks, and how the evolution philosophy is really responsible for a lot of the things we're seeing in our society today. I taught school 15 years, have a PhD in education. I've now spoken on this topic to about 700 times a year for the last 13 years. This is an active study of mine. I really, really want to help. I go visit prisons all the time. I went and visited the two boys in Arkansas that shot everybody in Arkansas. I sat across the table for 2 hours and talked to those boys. Our ministry donates thousands and thousands of dollars worth of materials to prisons and to prisoners. We're putting our money where our mouth is, okay? We would like to help. I would like to give you my unbiased opinion of what I think is causing the problem in our society. In our seminar part one, we talked about the Big Bang Theory and the age of the earth. In part two, we explained why the people lived to be 900 years old before the flood came in the days of Noah. What was the Garden of Eden like? Seminar part three, we talked about dinosaurs, where they fit into history. They're part of the normal creation. They were made on day six along with the rest of the animals. They lived with Adam and Eve in the garden. Noah took them on the ark. Probably babies, of course. Just be sure to get a pink one and a blue one. After the flood, people killed most of them. They called them dragons. And there could be a few still alive today. On our seminar part four videotape, we talked about lies in the textbooks. Things that kids have to face every day that are simply not true. They're being lied to. I mean, there's just no kind way to say it, okay? There are 30 or 40 some basic lies in every single textbook that I have seen, and all of them are designed to get the kids to believe in evolution. Now, in this session, we're going to focus on the last 150 years of history to see what the evolution theory has done to people's thinking process. Let's review some of what we covered on part four, and then we'll discuss racism, communism, Nazism, and the coming New World Order. Coming soon, folks, to a city near you, and then tell you, after we get you all scared when you see what's going on, then we're going to tell you what you should do about it. Okay? God's in charge. Don't get nervous. James Hutton, back in the late 1700s, started the idea in modern society that the earth is billions of years old. And we mentioned in seminar four that this was a time of anti-monarchy. Get rid of the king and establish a democracy. The Laodicean Age, Revelation chapter 3, the rule of the people. Well, James Hutton's book influenced a young lawyer named Sir Charles Lyell, and Charles Lyell wrote this book in 1830. There were a variety of people involved in this. It's hard to pin it on one person, but Charles Lyell certainly has to be one of the key players responsible for bringing us the evolution theory. He's the guy who invented the geologic column, which you kids have to study in school, and the geologic column does not exist in the world except in the textbooks. We covered video number four. We covered all about the geologic column. This fellow says, I myself have little doubt that in England it was the long age uniformitarian geology and the theory of evolution that changed us from a Christian to a pagan nation. And by the way, England today is a pagan nation. And I will quickly say, America is also a pagan nation. I don't know if we ever were a Christian nation, but we're not now. And we might as well get used to it, folks. We have to reach them. Like you reach the pagans, like they did in Acts chapter 17, with the creation message. Charles Darwin, who wrote the book Origin of Species, and there's more to the title, we'll cover that in a minute, he was strongly influenced by quite a few folks. He was influenced by Lyell. He was influenced by a guy named Malthus. Now, Malthus had written a book saying, there are more people born than can possibly survive. So it's best if the weaker die off. Well, Darwin read that and believed it and said, wow, well then, okay. That goes along with my theory of evolution. James Hutton's book came out in 1795. Charles Lyell took away the flood, and his book came out in 1830. Darwin's book came out in 1859, and he took away the creator. And boy, for the next 50 years, we saw the rise of all sorts of interesting philosophies. After all, if there is no God, well, then we must be God. And that led immediately to the rise of communism, socialism, Marxism, and the New World Order. Fred Hoyle, a famous British astrophysicist, said, "I am haunted by a conviction that the nihilistic philosophy, which so-called educated opinion chose to adopt following the publication of The Origin of Species, committed mankind to a course of automatic self-destruction. A doomsday was then set ticking." Well, Fred, I agree. Most of what we're seeing today really started 150 years ago when people rejected God. See, there are four great questions and two ways to answer them. Who am I? Where did I come from? Why am I here? Where am I going when I die? Evolution tries to offer four answers to those four questions. Creation offers an answer to those questions also. See, if creation is true, there are two ways to look at the world. Some people look at it and say, wow, it's incredible design. There must be a designer. That's the creation worldview. Other people say, nope, just evolved all by itself. The Bible says God created the heaven and the earth. But some people are able to look at this world and say with a straight face, you know, there's amazing. It's a big bang, made this from nothing. That's the humanist worldview. See, humanists put humans in God's place. They say man is God. Humanists regard the universe as self-existing and not created. That's the first plank in the humanist manifesto. Interesting. Evolution is the foundation for humanism. This fellow wrote a book, and in his book he said, "Do humanists believe in a supreme being?" Emphatically, yes. That supreme being is man. Humanists have no knowledge of any being more supreme. This guy says, "The turning point in history will be the moment that man becomes aware that the only God of man is man himself." Now, just who owns this world anyway? People get this idea, "I am God. I am God. I'm God. I'm God. I'm God. I'm God. Hey, Gabriel, come and listen to this. Ha, ha, ha." We're not such big shots, folks, okay? You're not God, okay? And the job's not even available anyway, okay? See, if evolution is true, then who owns this world? Fundamental question. Who owns the world? Who owns you? Who makes the rules? How do you decide right from wrong anyway? If evolution is true, how are kids supposed to decide right from wrong? They have no moral standard, no moral compass to go by. If man is God, and this is what a humanism means, then the strongest make the rules, might makes right. That's a natural philosophy that flows from evolution. There is no absolute standard, and there's no possible way to tell right from wrong. During the Civil War, one man decided he did not want to get involved on either side. So he put on a Yankee coat and rebel pants. He said, "Now they'll both leave me alone." Well, after the battle, he was found dead. His Yankee coat was full of rebel bullet holes, and his rebel pants were full of Yankee bullet holes. Folks, the problem is very simple. There's a war going on. We are in the center of the battlefield. This is the greatest war in history. All you need to do is decide who you want to fight for and get busy and work for your general. You cannot be neutral. You are either going to serve the Lord or you're going to serve the devil. You cannot be neutral in this war. There's a battle going on. Now, we as Christians have a tremendous advantage. We have a book that tells us how it turns out. See, and I read the last chapter, and we win. Okay? So what I'm going to share with you tonight might be a little scary in some points, but listen, don't get nervous. It's time to get busy. It's time to pour on the coals. We're going to trace a little bit of the history of the war against God to try to give you an understanding so you can see how it fits in with what we should be doing today. See, God created the world and He makes the rules. The Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He created it. About 6,000 years ago this happened. Satan, somewhere along the line shortly after that, decided he wanted to be God. I suspect that Satan fell from heaven about 100 years after the creation. Certainly before Cain and Abel were born. That's the first date we've got. Adam was 130 when that happened. We cover more on that on video number 7. But Lucifer, who became the devil, The Bible says he was perfect in his days, in his ways, from the day he was created. See, he was one of the created beings, and Exodus 20 tells us everything was created in 6 days. So Lucifer also was one of the created beings during those 6 days. He did not fall from heaven before the creation, okay? Ezekiel tells us his heart was lifted up because of his beauty and his riches and his power, and God said, I'm going to cast you to the ground. Isaiah tells us, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? Did you know it is Satan that is weakening the nations? He said in his heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. See, Satan wants to be God, but the job is not available, and he's all upset about that. So he's decided, since he can't be God, he's going to destroy God's creation, which is us. Bible says, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble? I think when we see Satan, we're going to say, that's it? This puny little fella, he was the one causing all the trouble? How many saw The Wizard of Oz, you know, when Dorothy finally got behind that curtain and saw that little old man, you know, back there pulling the strings and making the smoke? And this is the guy that did all this? Whenever I think of this verse, I think of The Wizard of Oz, you know. Satan's a puny little man who thinks he's doing great things. And we're all going to be amazed at how puny he is when we get to see him. This is the man that made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities thereof and opened not the house of his prisoners? Well, in the meantime, things are looking pretty bleak, okay? Satan and his followers are busy making their plans to rule the world, kind of like Pinky and the Brain. How many have seen that show, Pinky and the Brain? That's hilarious, okay? But we don't need to be nervous, folks. In Psalms chapter 2, the Bible tells us, why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, the rulers take counsel together against the Lord, against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. Did you know, God sees everything that's going on. He sees these people planning to rule the world, and he's laughing about it. And if we're God's children, you just stay close to God and everything will be fine, okay? There are some troublous times coming, folks, in the very near future. There have been more Christians killed in the last 100 years than in the last 1,000 years before that. There's a real persecution of Christians going on all across this planet. It hasn't hit America very bad yet, but it's coming, folks. Satan tricked Eve in the Garden of Eden. He said to the woman, yea, hath God said? Notice the first thing he did was to raise doubts about God's word. The second thing he said was, ye shall not surely die. Now he is calling God a liar. He's denying God's word. The third thing he said to Eve was, ye shall be as gods. He deified mankind. Eve, you do what I tell you, and you get to be God. Boy, the Islams have followed that one, haven't they? So have the Muslims. The Muslims, the religion teaches, you know, when you die, if you're a good Muslim, you get to go to heaven and have 72 wives. You get to be a god of your own little universe. The Mormons teach the same idea. 72 mother-in-laws. That's not heaven. Okay. Actually, my wife had a great mother-in-law, but Satan's technique has always been the same thing, folks, okay? He wants to make you doubt God's word, he wants to deny God's word, and he wants to deify mankind. Ye shall be as gods. That's what he did to Jesus, remember? After when Jesus was tempted, he said, hey, Jesus, fall down and worship me. I will give you all these kingdoms. He always does the same thing, folks. His tricks are the same. The devil took him up into a tall mountain, and said, all these kingdoms of the world and the glory of them will I give you if you fall down and worship me. Jesus didn't fall for it. He said, get thee hence, Satan. For it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. You know, a satanic high priest named Aleister Crowley claimed that his demon, Oasis, Iwas, told him the year 2000 would mark the end of the superstition of Christianity and the beginning of the golden age, when those possessing the will to dominate